What's going on, y'all? Today's guest is Shane Hazel. Shane Hazel ran as the Libertarian candidate for Senate for the state of Georgia. As of the recording, he was actually running still, but at the time this video is going to come out, it's going to be past the election already. And he didn't win, but he forced a runoff for the state of Georgia. And Georgia, you have to get at least 50% or more of the votes to win, at least the Senate seat. I don't know how the elections work for the other seats, but Shane Hazel was able to force a runoff and made the election very expensive for them. This was a really fun conversation. We talk about music, marketing, liberty, politics, and just things I want to get more involved in with the podcast. I basically want the podcast to form into music, liberty, and entrepreneurship, right? And all the things that come with that. Of course, all the amazing guests we've had in the music industry. We want to talk a little bit more politics and what liberty and freedom mean. And, you know, I am a liberty freedom fighter. And we'll have some amazing guests in the future when it comes to that. And also, and Shane Hazel is just a really great guest when it comes to explaining what liberty is, what libertarian values are. So this was a really fun conversation. Please go to the comment section, leave a comment, ask questions. We'd love to engage with y'all in the comments. Also, this conversation starts about 15, 16 minutes into the actual episode. I was an idiot and I forgot to hit record on the video. But if you want to listen to the full episode, I have a link to the podcast episode below. The podcast is the flagship of Making It with Chris G. It's the one platform that's professionally edited, and I have Mr. Jason Trosclair, my producer, making it sound really awesome for you guys every week. And then the video is just super raw. I don't do any editing. I just find the beginning and the end, and that's about it. So the podcast is the video version is the most raw version of the podcast. So if you want that authentic rawness without the professional Jason getting his hands on the audio of it, the video is for you. But the podcast probably sounds a lot better. But thank you all so much for watching and for listening. All your support. Please subscribe to the channel. And I hope you enjoyed this conversation with the amazing Shane Hazel.
Live the life you love.
To try to be as resourceful as possible and get the word out is in as many platforms as you can for the ROI, the return on investment. It's extremely challenging in 2020. And I'll tell you, I don't think that's a bad thing. I think it's a good thing that's going to, you know, what do they say? Necessity is the mother of invention, mm-hmm. right? Like for us, as Liberty people, I think we're finding new and important ways to reach people through social media, which is extremely cheap compared mm-hmm. to your ad spaces out here in Atlanta and everything else. So, you know, but here's the thing is, if people have suggestions, hey, why aren't you doing this? This is simple and easy. Present it to us. A lot of times, you know, we're pretty approachable people. We're not the crazy, you know, federal, you know, candidates out there that you can't ever touch. So, right. You know, if it's something that we need to be, you know, hey, you should be doing this for your ROI, just tell us. We'd right. love to hear that kind of stuff.
Okay. That's good to know. How has having a podcast helped reach people in general and like build an audience?
Yeah. I mean, obviously with thousands of hours of content, people can sit there and pick and choose. They can make clips. They can point to people in a direction. They can share a show where we go into long form topics, where we talk to other people even. And this is something I've done kind of recently is a lot of people won't come on a podcast with a guy that understands liberty and the Constitution and the history of this whole experiment and as in depth as I do. And I don't blame them. You know, like if I didn't have my ducks in a row, I wouldn't want to come on my show either. Right. But I have had a few people on to start discussing, you know, the ideas of liberty versus socialism or democratic socialism or communism, and to show people that you're a human being and that you want what's best for people and that right. you can communicate in a respectful manner. I think just even doing those type of things helps to break down those barriers to say, huh, you know, maybe I should give this guy a second chance, or maybe I should, you know, give this guy some more time to, you know, put a seed in my head. And that right there, just the ability to put a seed in somebody's head that's been indoctrinated their entire life by a, you know, government indoctrination system. I mean, what a gift. I mean, mm-hmm. to be that person that can go, here's a seed, have fun, see where the rabbit hole takes you. Like that's a big thing.
Yeah, totally. One of the episodes that really got my attention was when you had the girl last week. Was it Haley?
Yeah, Haley Wood. Yeah.
Yeah. That was such a good episode. And I was just like, I wish people could talk like that to each other, that have different opinions versus just screaming at each other, yelling at each other, disagreeing when probably most people agree on most things. And I was like, why can't we just have conversations like that? So that was such a cool episode.
Thank you. I wish people would talk to each other like that when they were online, you know, like instead of Twitter where we hate each other, screw you, right? Like it's, why can't you talk to a person like if they were standing in front of you? Extend them some respect.
Exactly. Totally agree with that. Staying real quick on the podcast, you use Restream for your podcast. I haven't seen that before. What is Restream and what made you decide to use that for your show?
Yeah.
Do you live stream every episode?
No, I've actually... it's kind of like what kind of mood am I in? There are some times if I'm expecting to have a guest or if there's something that's breaking that I just can't keep inside, right? That's where I'll use Restream. And Restream is a multicast platform. So, or I should say simulcast platform. So you can go in there if you got a Twitter account, a YouTube account. I mean, I think it's got up to like 30 something different platforms it'll stream to for some, I think it's like $19 a month. So it's fairly effective for the money. What you get out of it is the ability to live stream to all the major social platforms out there to get maximum coverage at the same time. I think it's a really neat tool, but it's a pretty easy setup. It's like I said, it's cost effective. It's going to take some fidgeting with your gear in terms of, like everybody's got different stuff, man. And that's the thing is everybody's got a different combination of stuff. I guarantee you someday, as soon as my life calms down a little bit, I'm going to walk people through this kind of stuff in terms of, what type of equipment do I use? What are the settings? How do I set it up so that we can get more voices, in this Liberty space? Because I think we need it. I don't think there's enough. I mean, until there's 24/7, 365, Liberty, everything on the major news networks, I'm not going to be happy.
Yeah. Same. I that's funny. Cause I was literally talking to my wife the other day. I was like, so I'm interviewing Shane Hazel and she kind of like knows about you already a little bit. I was like, really? Cause like, I'm really big in following your curiosity. And right now my curiosity is, so it's kind of started with politics with like Gary Johnson and then George Jorgensen. But then I was like, I really want to learn more, like the philosophy and everything behind it. So I started studying the founding fathers that pushed me. I keep going backwards. And now I'm at like Aristotle and Socrates. And there's this guy, John Locke, which I'm sure you're familiar with that. I want to start reading his books too. So anyways, I'm part of this whole big journey. I'm like, should I start a new podcast that's like Music and Liberty? Or should I just start introducing it slowly to my current music podcast and hope I don't alienate half of my listeners?
Well, I think there's a niche, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if I can get solid music and Liberty at the same time, and that's the thing you asked, like kind of how do I stream earlier or how do I procure my music? I mean, I'll tell you what, if somebody's not bringing me some new content or something doesn't pop up, like, and I don't know what it is and it's an interesting sound, like that's the only way, because I'm not listening to the radio anymore. And right. I mean, somebody like yourself who's sitting there going, oh no, man, I'm up on everything that's going on. I got these guys that are touring right now. I'm managing this. And like somebody who's an expert in the industry, boy, that's a niche. And I mean, like I said, 24/7, 365, you can talk about Liberty, you can talk about politics, you can talk about culture, but you could talk about music at the same time where you can introduce like some people like myself to really good stuff. Man, that's a great place to be.
Well, you'll be the first of many then. what inspired, so getting into politics a little bit, what inspired you to run for Senate and why as the Libertarian candidate?
Boy, I'll tell you what, I was just tired of all the bullshit. I, I grew up a neocon, so I kind of believed, everything star-spangly awesome that was indoctrinated to us, right? And so I ran off to war. I saw firsthand the horrors of it, right? I was in Marine Force Reconnaissance, which was at the time the premier like special operations type of unit. And so I went over in 03, I went back in 04, stayed through 05. And when it was all said and done, I probably had, a little over a year and a half in theater. And I mean, just super op tempos, went through a lot of the major battles like Fallujah and Najaf and D1E and all this crazy stuff. And you see it, man, you see the horrors of it. And you start asking yourself, well, what the hell is the mission? And you know, when I got to that point, it was, you know, it was like, all right, what do you think you know? Because it's been shattered in front of you. So I went to back, I mean, I became a student. I, you know, instead of trying to regurgitate everything Fox News was saying, it right. was like, let's go back in history. And yeah. I'll tell you, one of the best things that I got to do during that time was shut it all down. Shut yeah. down the mainstream media, stop listening to it. And I automatically became a happier person. Yeah, I mean, just
I bet.
Overnight, man, because it was like, none of this stuff is changing how I am on a daily basis. It's not educating me. It's giving me mm-hmm. talking points. And that's not like, that's not knowledge. Right. It's like, you know, what they teach in school, right? You mm-hmm. learn as quick as you can, regurgitate, forget. That's not what we need. We need principle. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I got back and, I guess I ran for, you know, after the Anti-Federalists, the Constitution, the Federalists, you know, understanding how this experiment came to be in the first place, I said, I'm going to get involved. I got a, you know, I've got a brain full of knowledge now, a lot of principle, and a, you know, I'm done watching a guy who's got a 50% constitutional voting record sit here and call himself, you know, a Republican
right.
That continues to vote for more war and more spending and more debt and more taxes and less freedom. Like, that's not what this is all supposed to be. So I challenged him, did pretty well for a first time out. And then Ryan Graham, the LP president of Georgia, came to me and said, you're a libertarian, you know that, right? And I said, shh, don't tell anybody. And so he goes, why don't you come over and make it official? And I was like, dude, I'm running, you know, psyops, and I'm doing asymmetrical warfare. I'm using my bag of tricks to dismantle the Republican Party here and sow disruption. And he goes, man, that's not going to work. And so after Ryan just kind of, you know, smoothed me down with his 550 grain, you know, sandpaper, I came over, man, and I went down to the convention in January and got nominated by some people down there to run. And, you know, it was I became the U.S. Senate candidate kind of by showing up down there, voluntold, I guess, is what we like to say. And so I'm blessed to be in this position. I mean, there were other guys that wanted to do this. I didn't necessarily want to, but, you know, I guess given the room and – you know, the podcast, it was people already trusted me. And, you know, if you can communicate the ideas and the principles of liberty in a loving way, in a teaching way, and still not take any shit, you know, from the people that aren't savable, like, I think people just gravitate towards that kind of thing. So that's how I became the U.S. Senate candidate here in Georgia for the LP.
What should someone know, I guess, before they run for political office? Like, is there some kind of... of course, there's probably no requirement, but like, what should be some requirement for someone that is running, whether it's for Senate, for Congress, or for even for local government?
I think in order to do well, you have got to be you, and never be afraid to tell somebody no. You don't have to listen to the system. You don't have to do it their way. Definitely don't emulate the two-party system. People like authenticity. Right? Like you can swear, you can cuss, you can be unpolished. You can not take donations. Hell, you know, in my campaign, I've told everybody, go give to your local neighbors, give to the people that are hurting, give to your, you know, your local businesses so that when times do get better, they're still around. Right. Be yourself. You better have some understanding of liberty. You better be able to communicate it well. You better understand the classics, the Mises, the Rothbards. You better be okay with guys like, you know, Dave Smith and Tom Woods and Ron Paul. And I know there are a lot of people in the libertarian circles that are more of the social justice libertarians out there that have a very hard time with that. But I'll tell you, you know, when it comes to the fight for freedom and ideas, the idealists are the ones that are unwilling to compromise principle. It's not that we won't take an inch where we can get it, but at the end of the day, that's how we feel about the whole thing. And I think, you know, more than anything is if you decide that you want to get into the arena, don't take anything personally. It's going to change your life one way or another. Mm-hmm. You're going to see some things, both good and bad, but you know, if you're willing and able to focus on the good, and maybe this is the most important. If you can constantly set your sights on the good things that are in politics and in the world and in your campaign, instead of dwelling on the negative things, being the solutionary person instead of being the person that's just there to beat up your opponents, right? Boy, that will take you through a campaign like nothing else will, because at the end of the day, I think those guys on the other side, you know, the duopoly, I think they would rather beat each other up than actually solve issues. Mm-hmm. And I feel bad for people like that.
Yeah. I've heard you talk about a few times how running as a libertarian or having a libertarian liberty campaign, that it's really tough. Like the chances of winning are pretty slim. And
so you're saying there's a chance.
I'm an optimist. Never know. I don't trust those polls.
That's right.
So, like, you know, running for president, Senate, House of Representatives, like, pretty tough. But for those of us, like people like me, people like you, that really want a multi-party system, that want candidates out there that are fighting for our liberties, mm-hmm. like what can we do to change the current system? Like, what can the average person like me do?
Yeah. So do what Chris is doing. Start something. Create content. I don't care if it's a podcast, if it's video, audio. I don't care if it's stuff on YouTube, if it's stuff on whatever it is, do something. Don't sit behind the keyboard every day. If you're a graphic designer, contribute to people with, you know, that are running with graphic designs. Help them with simple messages like don't hurt people, don't take their stuff, or right. you know, good ideas don't require force. Whatever your gift is in life, apply it to liberty. Make a job out of it. Create an income stream out of it. Maybe, you know, over time, even it'll become your job. And I'll tell you what, that's what the liberty crowd needs to compete with, you know, the duopoly here in this country. Is we need people who get paid in an industry of politics so that we have a, you know, basically a better chance of ever rolling back or pushing back this tyrannical system in our lives. But I would say if you're just creatively blank at the moment, right? Mm-hmm. Which a lot of people haven't, you know, they haven't woken up to that passion. Find somebody who gets under your skin and makes you want to do stuff and listen and share, and then maybe recruit other people to share their messages. And before you know it, maybe you'll be inspired to start creating your own messages. Maybe you'll see something from a different take, and it takes time. I mean, let's face it, you were indoctrinated from the age you were 5 till the age you were 18. And that's if you didn't go to, you know, college, right? Mm-hmm. If you think you're just going to rewrite the programming, you know, overnight, you're not going to. It's going to take right. years, right? I mean, unless you're a savant and you can just go, oh man, I got it all right now. I'm Neo. I just downloaded everything Liberty. I'm the best Liberty warrior there is. it's going to take some time. So don't be frustrated. You know, I've been doing this, you know, I've been studying Liberty since, I don't know, 2006, 2007. Okay. I got introduced to it by John Taylor Gatto when I was over in Iraq in his book, Weapons of Mass Instruction. And so it'll take you just as long to become kind of an expert in Liberty. But yes, go out there if you can't do anything else and just share the heck out of everything that the Liberty guys are doing out there, and recruit others to do the same.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm doing right now. I think I'm learning and sharing. Like I said, on my spam account, it's funny. So I literally have a spreadsheet, and that's how I do my own social media. When I work with artists, I have that same strategy for social media, but it's basically just this giant sheet of messages that repeat. And I send one out every 30 minutes, and it started off with just about 20. And then the more I listen to stuff, the more I learn. So like I listened to your podcast, I got added to the sheet, and I think it's up to like almost 80. But yeah, it's basically copy paste over and over again, sharing that message. And whenever something new comes on that's like current, then I share the current stuff. But yeah, that's got me connected with people like you, and I'm starting to meet all kinds of awesome people in the Liberty movement.
Let me say this too. In the Liberty movement, this is not super difficult, right? Like mm-hmm. when you want to do something and you set your sights on something, you know, I would say probably within a few years, depending on how hard and smartly you work, you can do this kind of stuff. You can have your own show. You can interview people that you probably thought you'd never interview. And I mean, before you know it, you're on a first name basis going, hey man, what's going on?
Right.
I'm starting a network and love for you to do some content on it or whatever it is. The possibilities are endless. And I think that's probably one of the coolest things about this Liberty crowd is like, there are niches everywhere. And the more you put in, the more you're going to get out of it. You know, the more liberty you do, right? The more you liberty, the more liberty that's coming right back at you, because this is a crowd that it feeds off of positivity. You know, it's a tough road for people that are always going to be negative, that just want to browbeat and, you know, mentally beat the shit out of people they disagree with. I'll tell you what, it's such an easier road if you're that positive person that just loves people from point A to point B, man. It's awesome.
Yeah, I completely agree. So I want to talk a little about your policies. So you have a few different policies that you listed just on your website, and you have defense, cannabis, guns, education, economy, privacy, religion, and liberty, property. Let's say the people of Georgia become wise over the next few weeks, and they also just had enough of the duopoly, and you do end up winning. What are the top two or three priorities from the issues that are important to you that you're running on?
We got to end the never-ending wars. I mean, bar none. And I think as you know, somebody has been there and done it and doesn't have a secondhand opinion, nobody can touch us on that kind of stuff. It's, hey, in the wars, you're the commander in the chief. You tweet about it all the damn time. Shut the fuck up and let's go. I don't care if you have to start, you know, a GoFundMe page where Americans buy airline tickets to get these guys back. I don't give a damn. You send the order to the generals, and as the commander in chief, they either follow your orders or they get dismissed. You're gone. And if I have to have captains and majors bring back the troops, then so be it. I don't care if I have to have corporals and lance corporals do it at some point. I'm bringing everybody home. The fact that we haven't declared war since, you know, World War II in 1942, it's absolutely insane that during my adult life, over half of my adult life now, we've been, you know, in other countries basically at war. And we've got to stop. I mean, the killing, people have no idea that haven't been around the Middle East and in areas like that. We've displaced millions and millions of people. We've killed probably damn near as many. The orphans that are out there, the people that are now disabled because of those things, that's got to stop. That's my number one. I mean, just absolutely stop all the damn war and bring everybody home. We're in 120 plus countries. They got to come home. That's it.
Yeah, completely agree.
We're broke.
Yeah. Super, super broke.
Super.
I grew up in Germany, and I remember in Germany, I mean, my dad was in the army, and there's bases all over Germany. Some of them have shut down by now, but when I was growing up in the 80s and early 90s, they're everywhere. Like almost every other town had a
Grafenwehr, Baumholder. What else we got over there? We got
Dexheim, Wiesbaden.
Yeah. I mean, everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Crazy. All over the place. So as I'm starting to get comfortable to start sharing stuff about like the Libertarian Party, the Liberty Movement on my personal Facebook page, not just a spam account. Mm-hmm. Of course, you get bombarded, and I'm starting to get bombarded from my own friends who are saying things
that's the hardest period in your life is
so hard.
When you start divorcing yourself from all the friends that you had in one side of the duopoly.
Yeah.
Right?
It's so hard right now. I'm like, I need some new friends. And another part of me is like, man, all my friends hate me all of a sudden, and I'm still the same guy. Just want you to be free.
Yeah.
But some of the comments I'm getting, you know, this is not the election to vote third party. A vote for a third party is a vote for Trump. I'm sure you've seen it all too. One side is saying that Trump is a authoritarian and going to spread communism, or not a fascist. And then the Democrats are socialists and are going to spread communism. Like, which one is the worst of the two? And how is the Libertarian Party different from the two of them?
I think the old saying is what, you know, if there's a boot on my neck, I don't care whose it is. The fascists and the communists, as they move further and further away from a constitutional republic. And I'll maintain we are definitely a post-constitutional republic at this point. Mm-hmm. And they will both slide further and further towards authoritarianism. And so it doesn't matter at this point in terms of Democrat and Republican. I believe the Democrats when they say Trump is going the fascist route, and I believe the Democrat or the Republicans when they say the Democrats are going the communist route. Yes. Right. No thank you to both of them. Yeah. Why should somebody vote libertarian this time around? I don't know. If somebody earns your vote, if you want peace, if you want liberty, if you want free markets, if you want your rights recognized and maintained as the foundation of our society, I think that's a pretty good society to live in, one that holds true to those principles. I will tell you, not every libertarian is worth voting for. So I'm not going to be that guy that says vote straight ticket libertarian. If there's some jackass out there, right? Like, and that's probably one of the other differences with liberty candidates. We're going to tell you, hey, don't vote for the person if they don't earn your vote. That includes us. I think that's one of the first reasons you should maybe consider libertarian voting. Here's the other thing. Personal story. In 2008, when I wrote in Ron Paul, when we had John McCain on the other side, the god-awful war hawk that he was, like, I walked out of that polling center and I felt freer. I felt for the first time like I had honestly lent my voice to something better and greater, and I didn't care if I lost. And so when that happened, I don't want to use the word slave of the system, right? But I was no longer a cog in the system. I was no longer going to continue to promote a lesser of evil because I was still going to get evil. Right. And this burden came off of my shoulders. I felt I felt great, to be able to sit there now for the next 4 years and be like, I didn't vote for him. I don't care. I think they're all evil as shit, yeah. Right? Like, that is a good thing. And we should always, this is a guy that's, been in politics now for, 4 years almost. It's like, listen, politicians are evil, right? And I'm not going to sit here and tell anybody, trust me, in terms of I'm a different kind of politician. Go do your damn homework.
Right.
Politicians, for the most part, want to be in power. And I'll tell you right now, as I'm looking in from the outside, I want to see people that want to reverse that. I want to see people that are like, hey, we got to end the wars. We got to end the Fed. We got to end this empire that we have around the world and the bureaucratic nightmare here at home. Like, how that's decentralization. If I hear people talking about that, I mean, that's how I'm going to have my vote earned. But I think in this time and age, I think that's the only people that are even considering these kind of things and the solutions, like criminal justice reform, are the libertarians. And it's awesome because you'll just see this list. Like, let's take, for instance, criminal justice reform. Mm-hmm. When you start to see people offering real solutions and the mind of everybody's involved in terms of trying to come up with decentralizing solutions for this. We started with, getting rid of immunity for all of the government, right? Like, right. Right now they have qualified immunity. You can't have two-tier justice system in America.
Can you explain real quick what that is for those that don't know?
Yeah, so basically under qualified immunity, if, let's just say, the cop that goes in and shoots Breonna Taylor in a botched drug raid, like, he's not guilty for having murdered an innocent woman. That's a problem, and they can't be tried basically under the same system. That's, you can't have immunity for government employees. What that does is it sets up a two-tier system where government employees are automatically treated with favorability. And that's what we've seen, over the past, 40 years since, Nixon and Reagan and all these quote unquote, freedom lovers out there, started the war on drugs is we've seen this explosion in, law enforcement going out and doing very heinous things and being treated with kid gloves and receiving, if anything, maybe a paid suspension, which we call vacation, in the rest of the world. Like, or a reduced sentence, or, you know, just being fired, but never being arrested, never going to, you know, never really facing, you know, the public for retribution. So that's the first thing that I saw come out is, you know, qualified immunity, get rid of the police unions, get rid of all public sector unions, stop the war on drugs.
Yeah.
Full stop. Getting rid of the militarization of police, right? Like, you start doing some of these things, and then people started adding on even to the back end of that, where they had community review boards in some places. Community review boards is one of the best ideas I've heard out of this whole thing. If you got a problem with a sheriff's office or a local police office, you know, if you've got 5 to 10 citizens who want to come forward and sit on a board and review somebody who has been out of line with the public, boy, I think that is a fantastic, you know, very simple solution that costs everybody about nothing. So,
go ahead. Sorry.
All right. I was just going to say, I think, you know, that's just one of those very easy ways to see how the Libertarian Party is full of solutions. And at the end of the day, they don't want more power. They want less.
Yeah. One of the things that drives me crazy is, so there's this bill, there's a few bills that I'm following, but what one specifically is the Ending Qualified Immunity Act from Justin Amash, and then the Breonna Taylor Act from Rand Paul, who is a libertarian and then a libertarian-minded person. Sure. And I've been hounding, so Stephanie Murphy, I don't know if you're familiar with her, she's my local congresswoman, and I've been basically hounding her, like almost started off on a weekly basis. I wrote her a letter, why, you know, those were important to me, and then I got a phone call the other day. From the office of Stephanie Murphy. I was like, oh wow, they actually give a shit. And she told me that she is for ending qualified immunity, and they have this brand new bill that they created that includes qualified immunity in there. And it's called the Justice in Policing Act. And I took a look at that. I was like, oh, cool, exciting. I'll take a look at it. If it's legit, I'll actually donate to your campaign. But if it's not legit, you'll hear from me again. And the Ending Qualified Immunity Act is a 4-page bill, super simple. The Breonna Taylor Act, 2-page bill. This Justice in Policing Act is 138 pages with all kinds of hidden agendas and money, more money going out. And it just drives me nuts. And another similar scenario is, you know, going to the music industry, there's this act called the Safer Stages Act. And the music industry right now is completely shut down because of COVID and we can't do concerts. Yeah. And, you know, venues are closing down, companies are going out of business. There's so many touring personnel that don't have jobs right now. And it is a bailout for the music industry, which I'm not necessarily for bailouts, but if the government's gonna tell me you can't run your business, then I need some money to support myself until I find another thing to do. But now that's got lumped into the HEROES Act, which again, all kinds of hidden agendas. And I love the original bill, but I'm like, I don't know if I want Safer Stages anymore. So I guess, what can someone do, let's say if you were senator, and what could you do to fight against that? And what can the average citizen do to fight against a bunch of things getting lumped up into bills, you know, taking really good bills and then lumping them into hidden agendas. And then they're using, this is a good thing, we're ending qualified immunity, but really you're getting all these other things too.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, that's what DC loves to do, right? Yeah. Most of the legislation that comes to the floor was not written by the legislators. It is written by corporate interests for the most part. And that's the problem. When you have a really, really large government, the corporatists come in, they lobby, and now they control a market through legislation. So you've got this cabal of DC and corporatists, whoever can pay the most money, they can you know, knock out the rungs to entry is what a lot of we say. Basically, they control the entire industry. So if it's a mom and pop shop or a local entrepreneur or something like that, the level and the money and the resources and the knowledge and expertise to get into it is huge, where it shouldn't be so, right? Mm-hmm. We should be able to come in there and do some creative destruction to see who's got the best ideas and the best, you know, policy and see what sticks. And even if there's just, you know, a certain amount, like a niche, right? Like that should be able to function. So what can you do? Call your legislatures, primary your legislators. Those two things, like example, I was pissed with Rob Woodall. Rob Woodall was the Georgia 7th, representative he still is until December. So I got involved and I started writing. I said, hey, you got to do X, Y, and Z or I'm coming after you. Mm-hmm. you got to do X, Y, and Z, or I'm going to primary you. So right. My eyebrows start to go up. I start getting phone calls. Hey, what are you talking about? Primary, blah, you know, basically, what are your concerns? Let's talk. Get their attention and tell them in no uncertain terms that you are coming for them. A group you are with is coming for them. If you don't do this, apply the pressure. They're your representative. And if you can use the Constitution to do it, which they are sworn to uphold per Article 6, Section 3 of the Constitution, You got such a good backing to sit there and say, hey, man, I want to like you. I want to help you. Here it is on a silver platter. Don't do this. Do this. Stop doing this. Do this. Whatever it is. If they will not listen to you and they're full of shit and they go, yes, I'll do that. And then they go up there and they continue to sign things like continuing resolutions and Defense Appropriations Act and all the other bullshit, you know, all combined, you know, piece of shit legislation that robs the people of their freedom and their treasure, then primary them. Get somebody to run against them. And for me, that was what I did. I said, all right, screw it. I'm getting in the race. I had no idea what I was doing. I had never run for office before in my life. And I went out there and I exposed a guy who was a 50% constitutional voting record for the scumbag that he was. That year, I didn't win. But he was within 400 votes of being kicked out of office by the Democrat in the Georgia 7th. Wow. Closest race in America that year. And on top of it, I called him after it was all over. And I got him, you know, I got his receptionist and said, he'll call you back. 5 minutes later, I had a call back from Rob Woodall. Wow. And in that conversation, I told Rob, congratulations. I hope you have a Merry Christmas and all this fun stuff. Understand this. This is the last time you will get elected because I stayed out of the general election altogether. The next time, I won't. And I don't care if the Democrat wins. I don't care if an independent wins. My only concern on this earth is you won't win. And guess what? 3 weeks later, the guy announces his resignation after the 2018 season. So you, as a single individual who may not have deep pockets, who doesn't have a ton of time or anything else, can still make a difference. At least that guy won't be in DC any longer, right? Like it's not a short game. It's not going to be a quick fix. It's going to be one of those things that you have to start devoting your life, you know, liberty and property to, man. That's I think that's what Jefferson said at the end of the Declaration of Independence, right? Mm-hmm. It was our lives, fortunes, and sacred honor. And they did it. Most of them died penniless and broke and destitute, and everybody, you know, a lot of people hated them, right? Like that's what liberty takes sometimes.
That's so funny that you say that, because I was telling my wife literally the other day, I was like, if she runs again in 2 years, I just might run against her just to get her out.
And that's what that's good. That's what has to happen. Good men and women have to do things like this, and it gets uncomfortable and it sucks. But in the end, I don't know. Chris, you got kids?
Yeah. One, a 7-month-old.
Here's the thing. When your kids look back in history and they see things like this and they go, hey, you know, I know where my mom and dad stood during these times. That's the legacy that I hope people will think about in the long game, is where did you stand? What can you point to? What can you show, you know, your kids? And here's the thing is, this generation is the first generation where they're going to be able to go back in time and know damn near anything they ever wanted to know, because we're all creating content.
Yes.
So your great, 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 great grandkids are probably going to be able to look back and go, that was my great, 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 great grandfather. Look at that. Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah, I love that. I'm going to go a little bit to the violence on the streets. So
sure.
I've heard several experts and very intelligent people, including you, talk about the potential, what everything that's going on, of the potential of civil war or states leaving the union. Mm-hmm. What are the chances of that happening? And is there anything that we can do to stop it? And maybe not the civil war part, but maybe is it a good thing if some states start leaving the union? Speak to that.
I think it is an emphatic yes, it's a good thing to decentralize. The anti-federalists, I'm sure a lot of the people out there don't. I'm an anti-federalist. When you read their work and you understand just how prophetic they were and how they saw the Constitution as a coup d'etat at the time, because they were living in probably one of the freest places on earth at the time, especially in the northern states. Mm-hmm. They predicted what would happen to the T, We've been straddled with debt. We've gotten into more and more war. Our freedom has been taken. Everything has been centralized where we have these solutions at the federal level. And I think, you know, we're watching the empire collapse right now. It's what are we doing to guide that in terms of peace, right? So if California, or let's just say California, for the sake of argument, wants to be the country of California. Cool, guys. I don't think you're going to get outside the suburbs, you know, in terms of, you know, going out there and, you know, those good farmers out there in California, they're not going to be down with that. So I think that's where that fairy tale ends. But, you know, like, there are probably going to be some places around some very liberal, progressive areas that might have a little bit of violence. And, you know, I hate it because obviously I've been begging for peace for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if it saves the rest of the country from a full on civil war, you know, where it's very asymmetric, where it's very guerrilla warfare, where the National Guard and the police or secret police and all that kind of stuff, like, we don't want to see that, man. Yeah. We don't want to see neighbors and kids and wives and dogs and pets dead. Like, that's the reality of war. Yeah. So, you know, the best thing that could happen is we could do something like a DC exit, right? Like, we've got 50 countries. We've got more people here in Atlanta than the entire U.S. population had in 1776. Mm-hmm. So the idea that, you know, we can't do something like this, that we don't have the resources, God, people have done it with far, far, far less. We have the ability to communicate. We have the ability to come up with mediums of exchange and replacing the Federal Reserve. We have the ability not to take on debt. We have the ability to defend ourselves. We don't need a centralized anything at this point, you know, and really to get away from it, I think is probably one of the best things we could do to promote peace in our lifetime is really decentralized. And if Georgia and Florida and South Carolina and Tennessee, they all want to get together and become, you know, quote unquote, a smaller country. I mean, it's got to be a positive over, you know, what we're dealing with now, right? I mean, that's my opinion.
Yeah. What would that look like exiting DC? So would that mean that all the states are just kind of running themselves versus having, I guess?
Yeah, in reality, I don't think it breaks up that way. What I think is it breaks up to I think places like New York, I think places like mm-hmm. LA, San Francisco, are going to be some of the hardest hit places, right? Because you've got dense urban areas that don't really produce anything in terms of sustainability. And those places are going to fall fast and they're going to fall early and they're going to leech out to try to grab things, right? And I think that's where you get some of your pushback from the local suburbs and definitely the more rural areas. But yeah, in terms of, you know, how it falls apart and what's left, I don't know, you know, in terms of states or regions, or, you know, what I would like to see is more of a county type, you know, organization where, you know, counties have a sheriff, counties have a mayor, you know, or, you know, a board of commissioners and things like that. And really most of the time people just want to get along. Most people, like I've said before, you know, when it comes to fight or flight, most people are flight people. That's smart, right? Let's live to see another day.
Yeah,
I gotta think that it's a much more productive and peaceful way. It's going to be different for different parts of the country. That's the truth. Is it's not going to be, you know, everybody's a state or everybody's a region. It's going to be very different, I think.
It's a scary thought to think if there really is a chance for civil war. Like, what do we do? Where do we go? How do we prepare ourselves? Like, we're literally thinking about that right now. my wife has family in South Louisiana, and I'm like, well, they're more likely to come to Orlando, so we're going to South Louisiana. Probably not coming.
That's right. Yeah, and that's the thing is, you know, it's you'll see during that time of instability, and I'd argue kind of in the beginning stages of it now, right? You see instability and people are just leaving California and New York and Detroit and places like that. They're leaving them in mass exodus, and the housing markets around here are going bananas right now. So I don't know, man. I'm profoundly, interested. And I think blessed to watch this, and be a part of it, this thing, you know, in the making. Like this moment doesn't come around, you know, every 150, 100 and, you know, 200 years, you know, and we got a chance to do it better than anybody or worse than anybody has ever in history.
Yeah. Well, I'm praying for better.
Yeah. Right.
But one of the other comments I always get when I post my libertarian content is you're basically just Republicans that want to smoke weed.
Sure. I mean, why not? No.
What is the libertarian stance when it comes to like human rights, specifically when it comes to the women's rights, the Black Lives Matter movement, not the organization, LGBTQ community, and how is it different from?
It's all your rights all the time, you know. And cannabis is one small part of that. You know, it's a naturally occurring plant on Earth. So yeah, we think you have the right to nature, right? We have as long as you're not hurting somebody else, which person, property, life, whatever. I don't give a damn. Nobody in the Libertarian Party, well, most nobody in the Libertarian Party gives a shit what you do. And it's more decentralization. That's what we tell people. It's not that we are better on social issues than Democrats and we're better on economic issues than Republicans and we're some weird hodgepodge of both. No, we are completely fucking different. And I can't stress that enough, right? Like we are the all your life, all your liberty, all your property, all the damn time, and you have a right to your rights, and nobody else has any power delegated to them to come and interfere with you at all. We are, you know, we're a band of cats, right? Like, you know, when people talk about, you know, groupthink and all that, like there's no groupthink in the Libertarian Party. We're probably sometimes our own worst enemy in terms of messaging and everything else out there. So I would say, you know, we are different because the principles cannot be altered within the Libertarian Party, or you're very quickly found out and you're excommunicated, much like Nick Sarwak, the former president, right? Like, where he's like, oh yeah, you gotta get behind Bill Weld, who was, I don't know, a lobbyist for Raytheon, right? Like, fuck, no, we don't, man. Like, that's not us.
Yeah, so true. One more political question. This one's from my mom. She said, what is the libertarian stance on the retired population and Social Security? Because like one of the things that
The
libertarian platform wants to get rid of is Social Security, right?
Yeah.
How do the elderly feel safe under libertarian leadership?
Charity. It's going to have to be charity. It's going to have to be society, you know, coming together in non-coercive, non-forceful ways. And this is going to be hard for a lot of people who have paid into Social Security and Medicare their entire lives. Listen, I hate it for us. I hate it for everybody. But it's a Ponzi scheme and people have allowed it. What happens to normal people in private Ponzi schemes? They get shafted. It's way worse when the government pulls a Ponzi scheme, because now you have generations and generations of people who have paid into something that will never, ever see it. We're $26 trillion in debt. We've got $200 trillion in unfunded liability. Like, Social Security, there's not a penny in it. There's not a penny in our entire system. And that's hard for people to hear and understand. But the fastest way to correcting that problem is let the market correct the problem. Don't ever let DC try to correct problems like that, because you're going to get something different, some other, you know, mastermind type scheme that's just going to take your blood, money, and treasure and probably your freedom all at the same time. So it sucks, but you got fooled. You've been had, and those generations, they had a chance, right? And it's upon our generation to make a tough choice. And a lot of people don't want to hear it, but guess what? I would rather go that route than saddle my kids, their kids, and the next kids with living out of our means today. Like, that's just, it's the responsible thing to do. How it comes apart, I hope, you know, I got to think that when I watch people, you know, run into harm's way from hurricanes and everything else, I got to think that that's what we do as a country. And, you know, if we're not allowing the government to come and take our life, liberty, and property by force and coercion, we're going to have some extra laying around anyway, right? Like, I mean, most of us are going to have about 20% extra laying around every year. Mm-hmm. We don't have to work till, what is it, May now?
Yeah.
The first 5 months of the year, we don't have to work for the government anymore. We can start applying that towards charity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that. Oh, one more quick thing. So in my search for like the for liberty and finding all different types of causes and organizations, I'm still reading into it. I don't know if it's a good thing or not yet, but I found this organization called Represent Us. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but some of the things they fight
for. Was that Jennifer Lawrence?
I'm not sure if I've seen her. She might be in that too, yeah.
Yeah.
But some of the things that they fight for, you know, they're also talking about the corruption of the duopoly, and they're not necessarily taking any party side, but some of the things they often talk about is having term limits, having ranked choice voting, ending gerrymandering, letting all voters vote in primaries. Are those things that can actually help maybe bring in other parties into our political system?
I think ranked choice is not a terrible thing. It's much better than the system we have. I think there needs to be a dual blockchain. But in terms of theory and idealism, voting just encourages theft and robbery of, you know, of powerful people, of non-powerful people. And so when we look at, you know, being adults and adulting in 2020, what we need to start looking at is, I don't need to vote for rulers at all. I don't want to be ruled. I can control my own destiny. I don't need handouts. I don't need the safety net of, you know, a broken promise from the government. And so they're trying to present solutions, and I hate to take a dump on anybody that's trying to do a better thing, right? There just needs to be guidance, and at the end of the day, it's got to be that ultimate push towards, I don't need to vote for anybody. I just need to be left the hell alone, and in my local communities, we'll solve problems the way we see fit, and you can do so in your communities.
Yeah, love that. Is there anything that you want to plug, plug the podcast, the campaign, whatever you want
to? Yeah, share? You can go to radicalpod.com or shanehazel.com. It's all the same site. But that's where all my stuff is housed for the most part. It's a work in progress because I'm doing it myself. I want to pick your brain at a later date, but I got to get the kids over to jujitsu here in just a moment.
Oh, awesome.
But I don't donate to my campaign. I don't need funding. I need people to share the message. If people see something out there that they like, if they're good at making clips, if they're good at making little memes or whatever, that's the kind of stuff that I need because I just don't have the time to do it.
Awesome, love that. And then the question I ask everyone at the end, and I would love to definitely reconnect and.
Sure.
Everyone like pick your brain about other things, maybe like after the campaign's over.
You can come on my show and we can talk music.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
I love that. But I noticed you do homeschooling and it looks like you have a homeschooling program, which is something I'm looking into right now.
Sure.
So I'd love to pick your brain more about that kind of stuff as well.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. My wife is a teacher by trade. You know, she went to Michigan State University. We decided that she would stay home with the kids and I would bring in the money and make sure that it keeps rolling. I'll tell you, our lives got better. It's been an absolute blessing to be able to spend more time at home with the kids and give those guys, you know, the most love and instruction and, you know, what our beliefs are in terms of heritage and culture. So it's awesome, man. I definitely recommend it to anybody. It's also up on the website, radicalpod.com. So if you guys are, you know, forced into homeschooling and can't stand the government indoctrination system, we're here to help you. And after the campaign and after we get moved into our new house in December, that's going to pick up a lot because I'm shifting gears and I'm going to start going after the cultural battle where I can promote radical people doing radical things and sharing that kind of stuff with the podcast and my wife and my family a lot more. So, but Chris, I appreciate it, man. This has been a hell of a lot of fun, man. I want to talk music with you a whole lot more.
Let's do it. Absolutely. I'm totally down. Count me in. Cool. And then the question I ask everyone at the end, just to keep it consistent, is what's your definition of making it?
Making it, man. Being happy. If you're happy, I mean, you got breath in your lungs and you can sit there at the end of every day and say, thanks for, you know, my life, for my family, for my health. Boy, I mean, for me, being happy is pretty simple, but being happy is no amount of money is going to buy it. And so that's my whole definition. So I guess I've made it.